Well, I think his work shall be. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. Blessed are they that do his commandments, that they may have right to the tree of life, may enter in through the gates into the city. For without are dogs, outside the city are dogs, sorcerers, whoremongers, murderers, idolaters, whosoever loveth and maketh a lie. I, Jesus, have sent mine angel to testify unto you these things in the churches. I am the root and the offspring of David, and the bright and the morning star. And the Spirit and the bride say, Come. And let him that heareth say, Come. And let him that is athirst come. And whosoever will, let him take the water of life freely. For I testify unto every man that heareth the words of the prophecy of this book. If any man shall add unto these things, God shall add unto him the plagues that are written in this book. And if any man shall take away from the words of the book of this prophecy, God shall take away his part out of the book of life, out of the holy city, and from the things which are written in this book. He which testifieth these things saith, Surely I come quickly. Amen. Even so, come, Lord Jesus. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen. Father, we thank you and praise you and honor you for the testimonies we've heard this morning. Thank you, Lord, that you do hear and answer prayer. Thank you that you've assembled us in the house of God to encourage us, strengthen us, to direct our attention to the Lord, his greatness, his goodness, his glory. Pray, Father, that through the message this morning, saints of God would be edified, sinners would be appealed to. I pray that souls would find help around these altars this morning. God, may our hearts be charged. I pray that we'd be strengthened. Ask you, Lord, to do a wonderful work in this service through Jesus Christ, our Lord, and in his name we ask it. Amen. You may be seated. I would like to speak to you for just a few minutes this morning on last things. I have just read to you the last few verses in the Bible. And this is the conclusion of the 66 books in the Bible, these last few words that I have read to you. In these last things, we have God's last promise to us. Jesus said in verse 12, Behold, I come quickly. This is his last promise to the church. Behold, I come quickly. He says that three times. He says that in verse 7, Behold, I come quickly. He says that in verse 12, Behold, I come quickly. He says that in verse 20, Surely, I come quickly. Three times in the last book of the last chapter, the last book of the Bible, Jesus repeats the promise, Surely, I come quickly. So that there's an emphasis on the return of Jesus Christ. In the last chapter of the last book of the Bible, Jesus is going to return. And so we ought to pay attention when God repeats something to us. Oftentimes we see things repeated twice, one strike after the other in the Scriptures, but not often do we see it three times repeated. This one chapter, Surely I'm coming quickly. He did not say, I'm coming immediately. But he said, I'm coming quickly. And so the Bible teaches us that we're to be ready, be watchful, that Jesus is coming in an hour when men don't think he's coming. So when the Bible says that he's coming quickly, he doesn't mean that he's coming immediately. We've been waiting almost 2,000 years. But he's still coming. Like the lightning shineth from the east unto the west, Jesus said, I'm coming quickly. That means that you don't have time to get ready if you wait till the moment he's coming. So God wants us to be ready ahead of time for the coming of Jesus Christ. His coming is more certain than your death. You may not die. If you are here when Jesus comes and you are ready, the Bible says, Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment. In the twinkling of an eye. There's something that's more sure than death, and that is the coming of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And so the Bible urges us to be ready, for in such an hour as you think not, the Son of Man cometh. And I ask you the question this morning, if Jesus were to split the eastern skies right now, would you be prepared to go if Jesus came right now? Is your record clear? Have you met the conditions of the Word of God for preparedness for the coming of the Lord? Jesus said, "Watch ye therefore and pray that ye may be accounted worthy to escape all these things that shall come to pass and to stand before the Son of Man." Are you watching? Are you praying? If Jesus were to come quickly this morning, would you be ready to go? This is the last promise that Jesus left us. Behold, I come quickly. Then there is the last beatitude. Notice in verse 14, "Blessed are they that do His commandments, that they may have right to the tree of life and may enter in through the gates into the city." This is the last beatitude, last blessing pronounced upon God's people in verse 14. "Blessed are they that do His commandments." We could say, "Blessed are they that believe the Word of God," and we wouldn't change a thing, because those people who believe the Word of God, they also obey the Word of God. So that when God says, "Blessed are they that do His commandments," He is giving to us the qualifications of entering into that city. They'll have right to the entrance of that city if we keep His commandments. I'm telling you, the Bible says this is the love of God, that you keep His commandments, and His commandments are not grievous. A lot of people like to emphasize God's promises and de-emphasize His commandments. But I want to tell you something about the commandments of God. Every commandment of God is also a promise from God. For God never commands anything that He doesn't give grace for us to do. So every command is also a promise from God. When God says, "I want you to do this," God does not leave it up to you to do it in your own strength. What He commands, He gives grace to do. And so those that keep the commandments of God, it's not those that just go to the house of God. It's not those that just make a profession of faith. It's not those that just assent to the faith of their parents. And it's not those that just assent to a way of life. And it's those that keep the commandments of God because they believe the Word of God and they love God with all of their heart, soul, mind, and strength. And these are the ones that has entrance into the city of God. This is the last beatitude. "Blessed are they that do His commandments, that they may have right to the tree of life and may enter in through the gates into the city." Then there is the last warning. Notice in verse 18 and 19, "I testify unto every man that heareth the words of the prophecy of this book. If any man shall add unto these things, God shall add unto him the plagues that are written in this book." Some of us may say in our minds, "Okay, well, I know people that have changed the book, but I've never seen the plagues written in this book added to them." You haven't seen them in eternity either. And so sometimes the things we don't see in this life, we think will never happen. But I'm telling you, you've never seen them in eternity either. And when God makes a promise, a warning, I'm telling you, God carries through on the warnings that He gives. And He said, "If any man takes away from this book, I will add to him." Or, "If any man adds to this book, I will add to him the plagues that are written in this book. And if any man shall take away from the words of the book of this prophecy, God shall take away his part out of the book of life, out of the holy city, from the things that are written in this book." I want you to understand how God values His Word. Now, this prophecy or this warning pertains specifically to the book of Revelation. But this same warning, this same type of warning, is found in other places in the Bible, so that God emphasizes the sacredness of His Word and tells us that if we do not value the Word of God and understand the sacredness of the Word of God, it's so serious to God, He said he would take our names out of the book of life, out of the holy city, and from the things written in this book. So that there is an awful, horrific warning given to us if we do not value the Word of God. God has given to us this Word, and He moved upon men, holy men, and moved upon them by the Spirit of God to give to us the words of life and light. And He said if we fail to value this Word. You know, Reader's Digest came up with a condensed version of the Bible. Thomas Jefferson gave his own version of the Bible. He cut out the miracles of the Bible. A lot of people would like to take the penknife to the Bible. So to cut out what they don't like. Maybe add a few things that they'd like to be in there. But God says my Word is sacred. And it is complete. And don't tamper with it. Just obey it. And do what it says. Because God has given to us sufficient Word in this Bible to save our souls and to provide an entrance for us into that holy city. Brother, we don't want to miss out on that. The gates of heaven are open to those who believe the testimony God's given in His Word and who have trusted Him and obeyed Him and kept His commandments. The gates of that city are open unto those people. This is the last warning. Do you get this? This is God's last warning. And it has to do with the sacredness of His divine Word. There is the last prayer in the Bible. In verse 20, He which testifieth these things saith, surely I come quickly. Amen. And John prays, even so, come, Lord Jesus. Last recorded prayer in the Bible, the prayer of the Apostle John, even so, come, Lord Jesus. Have you ever prayed that prayer? Do you understand where John was when he prayed that prayer? Here he is on the Isle of Patmos, banished for his testimony for Jesus. He's an exile. He's suffering. He's been beaten. He's been mistreated. He's been abused. He's a slave on this island. He's been put there, no doubt, to die. And in the circumstances that he's in, he said, I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day. I'll tell you something, brother. I don't care what your problems are, what your troubles are. Look at this man. Look at this man on the Isle of Patmos. His life threatened, his body bruised and bleeding. This man who has been tortured and subject to punishment for his faith in Jesus Christ. But on the Lord's day, I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day. I'm telling you, brother, we can be in the Spirit on the Lord's day right here and this day. We can be in the Spirit on the Lord's day. Don't matter what's been going on in our life. Don't matter what kind of troubles we've been having. We can be in the Spirit on the Lord's day. This man of God, persecuted and put on that island to die. Thank God he didn't die, but put on that island to die. He's tortured and persecuted, but he's in the Spirit on the Lord's day. It didn't keep him from worshiping God. His problems didn't keep him from praising God. His problems didn't keep him from having fellowship with God. And brother, no matter what our problems are, God will come to us in our time of trouble, and we can be in the Spirit on the Lord's day. Hallelujah. Praise God. Heard the voice of God, saw these visions from God. Prayed after the conclusion of seeing all these awesome visions of the last days. He prayed after hearing the voice of Jesus three times say, surely I come quickly. He prayed and said, my heart agrees. Even so, come, Lord Jesus. I wonder tonight, or this morning, could we pray that prayer? Would there be any hindrance to us praying, even so, come, Lord Jesus? Do you know that there are people who pray that prayer now, who are under circumstances similar to John, who are suffering for their faith in Jesus, who may not have plenty of food to put on their table, who scrap and scrounge just to get by from day to day? But they love God, and they understand that Jesus has promised to come back. And they know there's a city waiting on them, and they cry, even so, come, Lord Jesus. This is the last prayer recorded in the Bible. Even so, come, Lord Jesus. Then there's the last benediction, where he says, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen. Here's the last benediction given to the people of God. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Grace, the favor of God rest upon you. Did you not know that this is the will of God, that the favor of God rest upon you and upon your families? The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen. It is this grace that sustains us. It is this grace that God said to Paul when he prayed in the time of his affliction. God said, "My grace is sufficient for thee." The grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, godly in this present world. The blessing of the favor of God, the grace of God be with you all. The last benediction in the book. I want to back up here just a little bit. I want to show you the last invitation in the book. I heard my dad preach on this passage of Scripture over and over and over again in verse 17. "And the Spirit and the bride say, Come. And let him that heareth say, Come. And let him that is athirst come. And whosoever will, let him take the water of life freely." Before John closes the book, before God writes the last amen, before John finishes this final episode in the revelation God has given to us, God says, "John, write one more invitation. Tell them the Spirit of God is a calling. Tell them that the bride of Christ is a calling. The Spirit and the bride say, Come." And he said, "Let him that is athirst, that heareth, say, Come. And let him that is athirst come. And whosoever will, let him take the water of life freely." Brother, we just read just above here, if you read your Bible, we read about a river of life flowing out from the throne of God in that new Jerusalem. It is life-giving water. But that life-giving water is available to us right now through the Lord Jesus Christ and the power of the Spirit of God. And there's a last invitation given to men in the last chapter, the last book of the Bible. The Spirit and the bride say, "Come." And right now that call is going out from the Spirit of God, from the bride of Jesus Christ, the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. Come and receive this water of life so that someday you can sit by the river of life on the banks of the city, hallelujah, the new Jerusalem, and enjoy the water of life for all eternity. But you got to drink of it now if you're going to enjoy it then. And the Spirit and the bride say, "Come." And let him that heareth say, "Come." Let him that is athirst, if there's anybody thirsty here this morning, God's got an abundant supply. He stood by the well there in Samaria and talked with this woman, this low-life woman, and said to her, "Give me a drink of water." And she wanted to know, "Why, you a Jew, are asking me for water? I'm a Samaritan, and the Jews have no dealing with a Samaritan." Jesus said, "If you knew the gift of God, and you knew who it was talking to you, you would have asked of me, and I would give you living water that you would never thirst again." If anybody's thirsty, God's got a drink of water for you this morning. I said, if anybody's thirsty, Jesus has got a drink of water for you this morning. Hallelujah. And he said in this text, he said, "Whosoever will, let him take the water of life freely." It isn't something that you got to pay for or earn. It's something that's freely offered to you. That's the reason why you're going to be so responsible if you don't partake of it. It's laid at your feet. It's given. It's within your reach. And it is freely provided for you through Jesus Christ, our Lord. I want somebody to come and get a song this morning. I tell you, brother, we are living closer than anybody's ever lived to the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. And when He says in the last book of this last chapter of this last book three times, "Behold, I come quickly," we ought to lift our heads and take notice of what He said. He's given to us a promise, the last promise in the last chapter, three times. "I'm coming back, and I'm coming quickly." And the Bible tells us to be ready, for in such an hour as we think not, the Son of Man cometh. Was it Paul in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 says, "I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that you sorrow not even as others which have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with Him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them or precede them which are asleep. For the Lord Himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, with the trump of God. The dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words." And I wonder this morning, are you ready? Have you drank of that living water? Is there anybody in this house thirsty this morning? It's provided freely for you. Some of you may have a C.I. Schofield Bible. I got a Thompson Chain reference. Some of you may be reading out of a C.I. Schofield reference Bible. C.I. Schofield got saved and became a scholar, student of the Scriptures, scholar of the Scriptures. And he said one day, he was meditating on the Word of God, and he thought of this word, "Whosoever." He said, "You know, if God had put my name in the Bible and said, 'Whosoever believeth in Him should not perish but have everlasting life,' instead of 'Whosoever put my name,'" see, I'm Schofield. He said, "I'd always wonder, was there another C.I. Schofield that lived before me sometime, or maybe one going to live after me, that he was talking about that C.I. Schofield?" He said, "Oh, I would always wonder, did that really mean me?" But he said, when God said, "Whosoever," there was no doubt. I knew God meant me. And I don't care what your name is, you can put your name there. For when He said, "Whosoever," He meant you. Hallelujah. And if you're thirsty this morning, there's a drink of water for you. Living water that satisfies the thirst of every dry soul. Hallelujah. I want us to stand together this morning. Maybe there's some in this house that need to pray. Jesus is a-coming. That's the promise given to us. Jesus is a-coming.